Good afternoon, everyone. It is afternoon, isn't it? I think so. Who's enjoyed the morning so far? Beautiful. I just want to say thank you, firstly, for being here. Every TEDx speaker is very grateful that you're here because we get to share our stories and our ideas with you, so thank you. Now I get to share mine. When I was about 12 or 13 years old, I was at my uncle's farm and we were walking through a shed when something caught the corner of my eye. And I jumped and screamed. And my uncle turned to me, my uncle turned to me and said, "What's wrong, mate? Haven't you ever seen a piece of rope before?" I thought it was a snake, hence my reaction. I'm sure each and every one of you here has had a similar reaction when fear's grabbed hold, because that's what fear does. It causes us to fight, flee, or freeze. Now, I believe that fear can do something else as well, but I'll get to that a little bit later on. You see, I want to talk about the different types of fears. We have our personal fears, like fear of failing, rejection, change. Our phobias, like flying, heights, spiders and snakes. And then what I call our emotional fears. And that's when we are afraid to deal with certain emotions because the pain is just too great. You see, the brain is designed to protect us from pain, to keep us safe and keep us alive. And it uses fear as a tool. So the brain will protect us from both physical and emotional pain. The problem is it can't distinguish between the two, so it protects us from both. Now, protecting us from physical pain is obviously very beneficial, but protecting us from emotional pain, that can be detrimental to our mental health and well-being. Because if we don't deal with our anger and our frustration, our guilt or our grief, our shame or our blame, then that can lead to emotional turmoil further on down the track. Now, we all have our own individual fears. We all deal with them very differently, and we all, I suppose, respond in different ways. For me, for example, I have two major phobias, snakes and heights. And I hated the way that fear used to control me around them. So what I would do is expose myself to them. So every time I saw a professional snake handler with a non-venomous snake, I would handle the snake, carry it, put it around my neck. And that helped me improve my fear around snakes. I'm not great, but I'm much better than I used to be. And I did the same with heights. And one of the things I did was I decided to go bungee jumping with a few of my mates. Now, I'm not sure if anyone has ever measured out 40 metres on the ground. It doesn't seem that far. But when I arrived on the day and I looked up at the 40-metre tower, I thought, what the hell was I thinking? We checked in and we had to walk up what felt like dozens of flights of stairs. And with every step I took, the fear increased just that little bit more. When we got to the top, we had to sit down and wait, which made it worse. Every time someone jumped off, we had to move up a seat. And every time someone jumped off, they'd scream, which made it worse. What seemed like a very long time, finally a bloke walked up to me and put this big, fat, padded strap around my ankles. Now, part of me was thinking, thank God it's so tight, at least I won't slip through and go splat. But there was another part of me thinking, oh shit, I can't run away. Then it was my turn, and I stood up and I had to jump towards the edge of the platform. They then hooked on the bungee cord, and I had to shimmy to the edge. And I hung on for dear life. I then got my instructions. I want you to look out for the horizon and jump out as far as you can. Wait, what? If you jump out as far as you can, it'll make your transition to the bottom so much smoother. Oh, that sounds like a good idea. No, it won't. Then I'm going to call 3, 2, 1, and when I say jump, you jump. It was at this moment I was thinking, how the hell did I get here? Don't look down. 3. And you know what? I don't think I can do this. 2. Nah, I don't care what my mates think. 1. I'm not jumping. The next thing I knew, I was midair off the platform. And instead of, I didn't listen to a single word that I was saying or to the instructor, because instead of jumping out as far as I could, I sort of flopped off. It was the most insipid jump you've ever seen. I almost kicked my toes on the platform on the way down. And as I'm mid-air, I could hear myself screaming, and I could see the earth and the pool rushing towards me. Now, the reason why you scream in that moment, apart from the fear, is because you cannot articulate any words. But very quietly and very calmly to myself, I was going, I'm going to die, I'm going to die, I'm going to die. And then as the pool approached, the bungee cord got to its full stretch and it dunked me in the water like a biscuit into a cup of tea, and then it flung me back up again. I continued to scream, but this time it was with relief and joy. And I was saying to myself, I'm alive, I'm alive. That night, me and my three mates, we went out till 3 o'clock in the morning. We laughed and danced and hugged and talked, and we had virtually nothing to drink because we were so high on the events of the day and obviously a whole truckload of adrenaline. But I remember thinking at that time that I jumped despite my fear. And I looked back at that, and I jumped even though I didn't want to. And what I found was this courage inside of me that allowed me to do it. And also a sense of freedom by overcoming that fear. And I still carry those with me to this very day. Now, my fear around snakes and heights was very, very obvious. But what happens if you have a fear that doesn't only have the fear, the three Fs, the fight, flight, and freeze? What if it can control you without you knowing about it, like a stealth fear, control how you act and behave and respond? Not possible? Maybe it is. Check out this little bloke here. He's my hero, because when he was 6 and 7 years old, he endured more than what most kids should ever have to endure. Because during that time, he was sexually abused by a neighbour. And in those moments, fear took hold. And I know, because he is me. I can go back to those moments almost instantly. I can remember how dim the room was. Remember the air being stale, like the window needed to be open. And there was posters of hot rods and cars on his wall, and there was creases through those posters where he'd taken from a magazine. I remember how fluffy the bedspread was. And then I freeze. What's he doing? Why is he doing this? I want him to stop. It was in those moments that fear took hold. And never let go. Fear of it may happen again, of someone finding out, and being seen as a naughty or bad little boy. But then there's the emotions that are attached to it as well. The guilt, the embarrassment, and the shame of covering up for him and for lying for him and for what happened to me. But then something truly amazing happened. It was like a survival mechanism, and it took all that fear and that pain and that trauma, and it buried it deep down inside little Brett. It allowed us to have the most amazing childhood. And he carried that around with him for as long as he could, and when he couldn't carry it anymore, he gave it to me, the adult Brett, by which stage I was all of, what, 18 or 19 years old. You know, I was a man, I was hard, I was tough, I was strong. I wouldn't let that emotional bullshit affect me because that's a weakness. At least that's what I thought. But here's the kicker. The mind can play some terrible tricks on you because from the time I was about 18 or 19 years old, through to the time I was 50, I would look back at little Brett and I would think that he had a 20, 30, 40, 50-year-old brain in a 6-year-old body. And I would say to him, why didn't you say something? Why didn't you do something? Why didn't you stop it? And I blamed him for what happened to us. Now, logically, I know that's not true, but emotionally, that's how I felt. You see, that part of my past, it just appeared to be far too great to deal with, and so fear snuck in at the age of 6 and started to control how I acted, how I behaved, how I responded and how I felt. And I wasn't really aware of it. And I learned how to hide it very well. I learned how to mask it. I'm okay when I wasn't. And I numbed it initially with TV and sport and then later with TV, sport, work and alcohol. Because underneath it all, I felt like a failure, I felt like a fraud, I didn't like who I was. And the whole time, little Brett is screaming out for help. And as a result, I lived with depression for nearly 30 years. So what changed for me to allow me to be here in front of you today to share that story? There was a couple of things. The first thing was, I let my guard down. And a mate of mine saw past my mask and saw me, and probably saw a little bit of little Brett as well. And as a result of that, the second thing that happened is that he had a conversation with us, and it went something like this. Brett, you've got this deep, dark secret that you won't talk about and you won't deal with, don't you? Yep. And it's affected you in a negative way for a very long time, hasn't it? Yeah. mate, aren't you sick of living like that? Yep. Then don't you think you should do something about it? Yeah. And then he said these two words. It's time. In that moment, my life changed. It triggered something inside of me, and I decided right then and there that I was no longer going to let this fear control me anymore. And less than 2 weeks later, I was on the other side of the country doing a workshop with 50 other men. And they allowed me to deal with that trauma and that pain in a very safe environment, but a very powerful and masculine way. It was exactly what I needed. And what I did over that weekend is I worked through that fear and passed it and dealt with my past. And I tell you what, on the other side of that fear, I found this complete emotional freedom. And for the first time in my life, which I hadn't realized, I was void of fear and pain. And let me tell you, it was absolutely liberating. What else happened that weekend was little Brett was set free. Those fears, that fear that controlled me, did so for 44 years, and I wasn't really aware of it. Like I said, it was like a stealth fear. But I'm also very aware that there are other fears as well that are very intense and very short-lived and very, very obvious. When I got married, I realized there's different levels of fear as well. On our first wedding anniversary, my wife and I decided to go away for a weekend, and we went fishing, and we took our tinny away with us. I know what you're thinking, romantic, right? And we're out in the boat this particular day, having a wonderful time, enjoying each other's company. Now, my wife, by the way, Kim, she's this most amazing woman. Intelligent, strong, independent, beautiful, caring, loving, nurturing. Unless. And there's always a but, right? Unless there's a snake involved. And then she's just straight out batshit crazy, which I wasn't aware of at that point in our marriage. And we're out in the boat this particular day, and I see this big, fat, white sea snake swimming straight towards us. Now, many years ago, I was a police officer, and I had the opportunity to go diving with a professional pearl diver. And before we went down, he said, "We may see a sea snake." My reaction? I'm out. He said, no, don't worry. They're like puppy dogs. They're very friendly and inquisitive. They'll just come and say hello. Trust me. So I did. And within that very short dive, we saw five. When I saw the first one, very bravely, I grabbed him like a shield and pushed him towards it. And he signaled back to me going, "It's okay," and he starts patting it. I'm thinking, mate, are you crazy? By the third one, I'm going, how cool are these things? They're so inquisitive and so friendly, and they're amazing creatures. And I actually patted a couple of them. Exposure therapy, right? And so back in the day on the boat with Kim, I see this snake, and I said, "Hey, honey, check that out." Five words I immediately regretted saying. She jumped up in the bow of the boat and she starts screaming at me. Our day of tranquility had turned into hysteria on the water. My response was obviously, "But honey, he's just like a puppy dog. He just wants to say hello. He's being friendly." I shouldn't have said that either. I know that now. And then she starts swearing at me like a sailor. And technically, on a boat she was, but words I hadn't heard since I was a police officer directed at me. And that's when the real fear set in. And not Kim's fear of the snake, but my fear of Kim. You've never seen a man reel up his reel, pull up an anchor, and start a motor as quickly as I did in that moment. And we took off, leaving our friendly little snake in our wake. Whew. I'm happy to say, by the time we got back to the hotel, a very short time later, Kim had calmed down, and she was back to normal. Me, on the other hand, I'm still a little bit afraid of her. Now, Kim acknowledges that her fear around snakes is a little bit irrational at times. I look back at the way I behaved or my behavior around my past, and that, I think, as an adult, was a little bit irrational as well, because I made that out to be far greater than what it actually was in regards to dealing with it, because I didn't realize that the reward on the other side of that fear was far greater than I could ever imagine. To get to that reward, I had to go through a few steps. I want to share some of those with you today in case anyone may be struggling with their own journey. One, acknowledge that you may be not living the life you want to live or being the person that you want to be, a bit like myself, and make a decision to change. Two, explore what works for you. For me, it was a workshop. For someone else, it could be totally different. But when you do, do it immediately. Because if you don't, fear will get into your head and may say something like this: "It's okay, you'll be fine. You don't have to deal with that. you've got this far. Let me just tell you, fear is friggin' lying to you. And three, and this is the big one, work on it every day. Be persistent and consistent. It can change your life dramatically in such a quick time period. Now, I look back on how fear caused me to act, behave, respond, numb, mask, withdraw, and I wasn't really aware of it for 44 years. And as a result, I lived with depression, felt like a failure and a fraud. I didn't like who I was, and I sabotaged relationships, business, and work. And you know what? None of that was me. You see, fear made me the man I wasn't. It wasn't until that moment when my mate said to me, "It's time." That was my sliding door moment, my moment of clarity. And we all have those moments. We just have to recognize them. So whether your moment is right now or sometime in the future, when that moment arrives, I want you to recognize that moment and say to yourself these two words: "It's time." Because those moments can have a profound effect in such a positive way in our lives. You see, I believe we can all live the life we want to live and the life we deserve to live. We just have to recognize those moments. Recognize what's holding us back, our fear. It doesn't matter what sort of fear it is, it can hold us back. Confront it and overcome it. We can all do that because we have this courage inside of us, each and every one of us, to overcome even our greatest fears. Believe me, I know. Someone once said, "The best things in life are on the other side of fear." So can you imagine what you may find on the other side of your greatest fear? Because you know what I found on the other side of my greatest fear? Me,